preparing this lecture in Rome, I was thinking, okay, I was here 5 years ago, And what has happened in the church since I was here 5 years ago? And I, as I reflected on that, I realized that a turning point was March 13th, 2013. I was standing in the rain in St. Peter's Square with some of my friends on that historical day. We were packed like sardines as we looked up at the white smoke coming from near the Sistine Chapel. And amazingly, though it seemed impossible to move an inch in any direction, when the windows of the loggia opened, we were pushed forward about 10 feet. It was the first time in my life I felt like I was flying without being in an airplane. I was literally swept off my feet. And I wanted to show you where I was at in St. Peter's Square, just so you know here. Look at this. I was right back there. Can you see me? Well, that climactic moment of Habemus Papam was really one of puzzlement for us all. First of all, the Pope came out so simply, as you know, and everyone was asking, well, who is this Cardinal Bergoglio? Finally, an Italian next to me looked Bergoglio up on his cell phone, on his iPhone, and he said, well, he's a Jesuit from Argentina. And of course, all of us said, what? A Jesuit from Argentina? How is it possible? We were even further surprised when he chose the name Francis, as I'm sure you were too. Well, Pope Francis has a lot to say about not only living the good news contemplatively, but sharing the good news in a world of chaos. And for this reason, I've decided to focus on two of his writings, The Joy of the Gospel and the most recent encyclical, Laudato Si, as a framework for my reflections this afternoon. The Joy of the Gospel, the English title of the apostolic exhortation, Evangelii Gaudi, invites us to an experience, to both experience the good news of Jesus Christ and to share it with others. He uses the word joy 59 times. And he reminds us that the joyful living of the gospel is at the heart of being a credible witness of Christ in today's chaotic world. And this joy has its roots in a personal encounter with Jesus. Now, the most recent encyclical, Laudato Si, on care of our common home, is, I think, much more than an ecological encyclical. It proposes a way of life that helps us first to live in harmony with creation, second, to safeguard the earth for future generations, and most importantly for us this evening, to live contemplatively in a world of chaos. Now, much of the popular press has focused on Pope Francis, what he said about climate change and inequality. These are key ideas, I'm not denying that. But as the Orthodox theologian Metropolitan John of Pergamon noted, this is John Zizoulas, for those of you who are theologians, he's written some marvelous books on the Trinity, this Orthodox theologian who introduced the document at the Vatican introduction of it. When he gave his first account, he said, when he gave his address to launch the encyclical, he said, and I quote, The ecological crisis is essentially a spiritual problem. The ecological crisis is a spiritual problem, and I'd like to suggest that the encyclical offers us practical advice on solving this spiritual problem. So, this is what I want to do this evening, using Evangelii Gaudium and Laudato Si as sort of a framework. I'm going to divide my comments into three parts. The first is a biblical overture. In Evangelii Gaudium, Pope Francis cites St. Paul's letter to the Corinthians seven times. To the Philippians seven times. Seven times. That's quite a lot for one little letter in an encyclical. An apostolic exhortation, sorry. Including the passage, "Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice." This brief scriptural focus will set the foundation for what follows, because in the second part, I want to focus on the idea that joy is contagious. Joy is contagious, and this is certainly one of the messages in Evangelii Gaudium, that joy is contagious. And we want to look at what it says about sharing the good news with others in today's world. And finally, in the third and final part, I want to use Laudato Si as a framework for considering five best practices for proposing a spirituality that opens for us a way to live more contemplatively and to share the good news in a world of chaos. So this last section is, I think, a little bit, you might be surprised at how I'm developing it, but I think you can decide at the end if I'm right or not, okay? So the first section, the biblical overture. Philippians 4:3, rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. It's like a golden thread woven in that letter of St. Paul to the Philippians. Paul is a fantastic guide. He's a fantastic guide to lead us to the depths of the good news and on how to share it with others, also in this chaotic world in which we live. Because Paul is an expert on this because he himself lived in a chaotic world. And so the church community to which Paul wrote, they were a lot like the people in Australia, organized, generous Christians who had many gifts. But if you read between the lines, you discover that, like every community and Christian institution, the Philippians were not perfect. They were not perfect. The community had both internal and external problems. For example, in the context of inviting the Philippians to rejoice in the Lord, Paul had to deal with a serious disagreement between two important women in the community. They didn't exactly get into a fist fight, but things were so serious that Paul had to send someone to mediate peace between them. In other parts of the letter, Paul admonishes the community to avoid egoistical behavior, ambition, and vainglory. He exhorts them not to murmur or fight with each other. So it's clear that he wouldn't have had to mention those things if there weren't problems in the community. So good people, but problems. So the community itself was a bit chaotic. Now, Paul also alludes to problems outside the community, including opposition and persecution. Now, we know that Paul's personal situation was not the best. though scripture scholars disagree, where Paul was in prison, most of them would agree that he was in prison somewhere, either Rome, Ephesus, Caesarea. Most acknowledge that this letter was written from prison. And if you read between the lines, you'll also notice that Paul was having financial problems and finding it difficult to make ends meet. So in the midst of these internal and external problems, Paul encourages the Philippians to rejoice in the Lord. So in one way or another, this brief letter makes 16 references to joy. Okay, Pope Francis mentioned joy 59 times, but his apostolic exhortation is a little bigger than the letter to the Philippians, huh? So Paul invites the Philippians and us to rejoice in the situation that we find ourselves in. In this context, he invites the Philippians and us, by extension, to rejoice in the Lord. And he repeats it twice to just make sure you got it. Rejoice. Again, I say rejoice. It's not just an individual rejoicing, but a collective one. We're called to rejoice together in the Lord because the Lord is near. So if Christ is the real source of our joy, absolutely nothing can take that joy away. Paul is convinced that this joy we experience has an effect on our behavior. And so he says, let your kindness, your affability, your gentleness be noted by all, because the Lord is near. And so as we enter into the joy of the gospel, it leads us to become more generous, more understanding, more courteous, more loving, more tolerant towards others. It makes us tender-hearted and merciful in our relationships. Paul invites us to an open and ample space within ourselves so that we can experience that joy of the Lord and be on the same wavelength with the Lord, a wavelength which is one of tenderness and mercy. So what's Paul saying to us today before we move to the second section? First, he's inviting us to rejoice together in the Lord in every situation. Like the church in Philippi, maybe your church, your community, your college, your university, your family may not be perfect. Sometimes we experience divisions and misunderstandings. The reality is, though, that to give a credible witness to the gospel, we can't do it if we're divided. Paul invites us to patiently work for reconciliation and at the same time to remain joyful in the Lord, who is very near. Now, if you read the newspaper or listen to the news on television, it could seem that there is very little to rejoice about in the world. The world is in chaos. I think of the conflicts in Syria, the persecution of minorities in the Middle East, human trafficking, especially the plight of children, the plight of refugees, and so many other terrible situations. Certainly, we need to do what we can to alleviate that suffering. But at the same time, Paul would say we're called to do so with joyful trust, because even there, the Lord is near. And finally, we may not find ourselves in prison like Paul, but there are moments in our lives when we feel deep darkness, or big problems, moments of crisis, family problems, sickness, other difficulties. And also, this can be gift. As Mary Oliver says in her poem, The Use of Sorrow, someone I once loved gave me a box of darkness. It took me years to understand that this too was a gift. why rejoice in these situations? Quite simply because the Lord is near. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted. The Lord is near to those who call on his name. Part of our problem is that we just don't understand how very close the Lord is to us and how much he loves us. So Paul invites us, as I said earlier, that this would flow, this experience of joy would flow into our relationships. And this reminds me of a phrase of Pope Francis, where he talks about the smile of the gospel. In one of his discourses, he's talking to seminarians and religious. And he says, people today certainly need words, but above all, they need the witness that we witness to the mercy, the tenderness of the Lord, who warms the heart, who awakens hope, and who draws us towards doing good. But we can't bring joy to others unless we have first experienced that joy ourselves and been consoled by the Lord, loved by him. And this brings me to my second point, and that is that joy is contagious. We have here a quote from Evangelii Gaudi of the first line, where the Pope says, the joy of the gospel fills the lives and hearts of those who encounter Jesus. Those who accept his offer of salvation are set free from sin, sorrow, inner emptiness, and loneliness. With Christ, joy is always born anew. I have my own particular way of summing up Evangelii Gaudi, and I hope you won't think it's too corny or too crazy. But anyway, I'm going to share it with you. Well, I like to use the acronym JOY and use the words Jesus, others, you. I really think that this is, in a nutshell, is what Pope Francis is saying to us, Jesus. The key to living Christian joy is to live for Jesus, or better, to live Jesus so that he becomes the center of our existence. And so Pope Francis invites all Christians everywhere, even us right now, and he says, all Christians everywhere, at this moment, he invites us to a renewed personal encounter with Jesus Christ. No one is excluded. No one is excluded from the joy brought by the Lord. And he says, the Lord does not disappoint those who take the risk. Whenever we take a step towards Jesus, we come to realize that he is already there, waiting with open arms. So with great simplicity and immediacy, Pope Francis invites us now and says to say to the Lord, Lord, I have let myself be deceived in a thousand ways. I have shunned your love, yet here I am once more to renew my covenant with you. So the first is the key. And it's the key not only for Evangelii Gaudi, but also for Laudato Si. The key is that personal relationship with Jesus. But then we're invited to think of others. What happens when we have that renewed encounter with Jesus Christ is the Pope says we're liberated from our narrowness and self-absorption. At this point, we're really ready to share the good news with others. So all are called, he says, through our baptism. And evangelization is not just for nuns and priests or professionals, it's for all of us because of our baptism. We're all called to witness to God's love and to live our lives in service of others, especially the poorest of the poor. So, he says, we're invited to dedicate ourselves to pour out our lives for them. Jesus, others, you. And finally, yes, we are in the third place. We're invited to die daily to our selfishness, our self-absorption, etc. So, if we take this to heart, Pope Francis offers us both an invitation and a challenge. He says, if this is the case, an evangelizer must never look like someone who's just come back from a funeral. Let's discover, recover, and deepen our enthusiasm, the delightful and comforting joy of evangelizing, even when it is in tears that we must sow. So he's not denying that there are moments when we're sad, but underlying that is a joyful trust in the Lord. A second passage that I like a lot is this one, and it's very important. There are Christians whose lives seem like Lent without Easter. Have you ever met anyone like that? And sometimes, if we're honest, we're like that. He says, I realize, of course, that joy is not expressed the same way at all times in our life, especially at moments of great difficulty. Joy adapts and changes, but always endures, even as a flicker of light born of our personal certainty that when everything is said and done, we are infinitely loved. So, in that context, all of us are called to be missionaries of that joy, of that love of God in Jesus Christ. Now, I realize that a lot of energy and time has been spent in the church on teaching us or encouraging us to share the good news with other people. But you know, I have to ask myself honestly and ask you, has it really worked? Has it really worked? You know, what's the real situation in our churches after, for example, the Synod on Evangelization, after a new council on evangelization in the Vatican, after in various dioceses, even like here, offices of evangelization? How is it affecting ordinary Christians? So for this, I have some statistics. Now these were taken before Evangelii Gaudi came out. And they're from the United States. And the question was asked, what are you doing to evangelize? Asking ordinary parishioners. What are you doing to share the good news of Jesus Christ? So 75% of conservative Protestant congregations and 57% of African-American congregations replied affirmatively, we are doing something to evangelize. Whereas only 6% of Catholic parishes did that. Asked whether they sponsored local evangelical activities or activities of evangelization, only 3% replied positively. So granted the survey is a few years old, I still ask myself how much has changed. I mean, I live in Rome, and things change very slowly in Rome. There are some efforts. The other day I was in the garden, walking on a Sunday in a garden, and someone came up to me, and there was a little prayer service going on. It was run by a Catholic parish. So they were trying to encourage people to go over and listen to the gospel on Sunday in a garden in Rome. That's pretty good, no? So there are efforts going on, but how is it affecting ordinary parishioners? It's a big question. And so certainly there are different ways of evangelizing, and of course person to person, you know, just sharing the good news with the people we meet, opportunities on the street, in the city square, during work on a journey. Or, of course, evangelizing a culture through schools and universities and organizations. And then Pope Francis emphasizes a lot that we share the joy of the gospel above all by our practical commitment to the poor and the most vulnerable. And he's really insistent on this, that it's really part of our Christian vocation to have a concern and a care for the poor. Because he says there can be no credible witness of the gospel without some service, concrete service, to the poor. It's an essential part of the gospel of joy. So these are just a few ideas from Evangelii Gaudi. Now let me move to the third and the final section. What I would call best practices for a practical spirituality, an ecological spirituality for living contemplatively and sharing the good news in a world of chaos. Now, before focusing on this practical spirituality, I want to just make three preliminary points. First of all, if you've been following, first of all, let me ask this, how many have read Laudato Si? Okay, good. Okay. For those of you who haven't read it, I'm going to make a suggestion that you read the last chapter first. And I'll explain afterwards why I think you should do that. Okay, three preliminary points. If you're following what the press is saying, it's evident, of course, that Pope Francis follows scientific consensus and suggests that global warming is due largely to human activity. Some people disagree with him, fine. He also emphasizes that there is an evident connection between environmental problems and poverty. And I quote him, "Never have we so hurt and mistreated our common home as we have in the last 200 years." He wrote, insisting that humanity can no longer afford, quote, to delaying the important decisions and pretending nothing will happen. So that's what he says. Now the second point I want to make is that Laudato Si is not a typical church document. It's not. First of all, it's addressed to all people of goodwill. So there have been other, it's not the first time this has happened, but certainly this, in recent years, this is very significant. And it is very clearly open to dialogue with others. At the same time, it embraces and deepens a steady stream of social teaching. And you see this if you look at the footnotes. Footnotes are wonderful things. There are 172 footnotes in this. And you see lots of references to John Paul II, to Benedict, to other popes, to bishops' conferences. This was a big, an interesting thing, how many times the Pope quotes bishops' conferences. There are also references to the Patriarch of the Eastern Orthodox Church. Usually the Pope doesn't quote the Orthodox bishops. This usually doesn't happen in papal encyclicals. Thomas Aquinas is cited, which is good, and also a Sufi mystic from the 9th century, Pierre de Chardin, and Romano Guardini. So it is quite, yeah, there's a lot of breadth and depth. And I liked what John Ellen said, an American journalist. He says, if Laudato Si is an earthquake, it had many tremors beforehand. And what he means by this is that, you know, we have to see it in the context of many years of social teaching of the church. There are some new things in it, but it's built on the past. And that's very important. Now, I'm not going to go through the whole, each chapter, because what I want to do is focus on chapter 6. But let me just briefly remind you of how it develops. So the first chapter is what is happening to our common home. It's focusing on the problems. The problems. Chapter 2, the gospel of creation, is very beautiful because it focuses, it offers us a scriptural reflection. And the Pope selects various biblical accounts and from the Judeo-Christian tradition. And what he does is he tries to articulate that really we have a tremendous responsibility. We have a tremendous responsibility to take care of creation and to recognize the connection between ourselves and creation. And I quote, "and the fact that the natural environment is a collective good." the patrimony of all humanity and the responsibility of everyone. And the chapter concludes, of course, with a focus on Jesus, who is the Lord of all creation. The third chapter focuses on the human roots of the ecological crisis, that is, the deep concerns, the deep causes, not just looking at the symptoms, but why? Why do we have these problems? Chapter 4 focuses on an integral ecology. And this is really the heart of the encyclical, and it offers really a new paradigm of justice, an ecology, and I quote, which respects our unique place as human beings in the world, in our relationships to our surroundings. So he says, nature cannot be regarded as something separate from ourselves or as a mere setting in which we live. Chapter 5, lines and approaches of action. Basically, he says, what we can and what we must do. And this touches not only us as individuals, but us as communities and as the whole international community in dialogue with one another. Now, the sixth chapter, which is what I want to talk about in the last part, the moments that we're together. It's called Ecological Education in Spirituality. And basically, what he calls for and what he invites us to is an ecological conversion. And what I'd like to do now is focus on what that might mean and what best practices we could glean from this document. So, the first thing is this. We're invited to a new way of life. It's a new way of life. And look at this quote here, it's quite extraordinary. He says, Christian spirituality encourages a prophetic and contemplative lifestyle. Encourages a prophetic and contemplative lifestyle, one capable of deep enjoyment, free of obsession with consumption. We need to take up an ancient lesson found in different religious traditions and as in the Bible. It's the conviction that less is more. So what's proposed here is that we move towards a simpler lifestyle that's more eco-friendly and open to solidarity with others. So with this in mind, I want to suggest 5 best practices. Okay, the first best practice is be connected. The first words of the encyclical, Laudato Si, praise be to you, draws us to St. Francis's beautiful canticle. Listen to the words, it's so beautiful. Praise be to you, my Lord, through our sister, Mother Earth, who sustains and governs us, and who produces various fruits with colored flowers and herbs. This accents how deeply connected we are with all creatures and all creation. So, what's a first best practice? A first best practice is simply to be aware, to be attentive, to be mindful of this connectedness with all creatures and all creation. And this reminds me of a short poem by Mary Oliver who says, who writes, instructions for living a life. Pay attention. Be astonished. Tell about it. Instructions for living a life. Pay attention. Be astonished. Tell about it. If we could just do this. Our loss of contact sometimes with nature really has an impact on our spiritual lives and on our relationships with the world, especially for those who sit behind computers all day and who are constantly connected to our cell phones and to the internet. We can't really underestimate how this affects our relationships with other people and with all creation. So a first step might be simply to be connected not to the internet, but to nature. Celebrate this connectedness with creation. And also be aware that our technological excesses can really block us from this connectedness. Pope Francis writes, and I quote, "A constant flood of new consumer goods can baffle the heart and prevent us from cherishing each thing and every moment." He also says, technology tends to absorb everything into its ironclad logic. In the most radical sense of the term, power is its motive, a lordship over all. I came across recently what turns out to be one of those viral videos. And it's about our reliance on technology. And how, at a certain point, it stops being neutral and how it starts being a problem. So what happened is an interviewer interviewed three generations and asked, what do you as children do for fun? What did you do as a child for fun? So a grandmother and father, a mother and father, and then two children. So the two older generations talked about building forts and picking blueberries. The younger generation talked about mastering video games and binge-watching streaming television shows. So there is something innately wrong. Something's wrong here with the picture, and it's something to be concerned about. I recently came across a book called The Scent of Lemons, very interesting title. And it's written by the priest Jonah Lynch. And it's really about, the subtitle is Technology and Relationships in the Age of Facebook. And basically this guy starts out about his own experience in reading scripture. He said all of a sudden he found himself reading scripture like he was reading, you know, the news on the internet. And he said, what's going on here? What's going on here? And this led him to this beautiful reflection in this book called The Scent of Lemons. You might want to read it. Okay, the first point, be connected. The challenge is to be connected, not to the internet, but to nature. The second point is, there are only five, so don't worry. The second one is to be grateful. To be grateful to God for creation, for the gift of what God has given, for the beauty of the earth. In a recent New York Times article, there was an article by David Brooks, and it really struck me. He talked about cultivating dispositional gratitude. And he said, people with dispositional gratitude take nothing for granted. They take a beginner's thrill at a word of praise, at another's good performance, or at a sunny day. And then I like what he said, because it relates to that Mary Oliver poem too. These people are present-minded and hyper-responsive. Isn't that great? So this idea of being grateful, cultivating this gratitude in our lives will make us also present-minded and hyper-responsive. And this dispositional gratitude induces a mentality that stands, he says, in counterbalance to the mainstream threads of our society, of our culture. So it's a big challenge. The third point. The third point is repent. And here I quote Metropolitan John of Pergamum, as I did earlier, where he says that the ecological crisis is a spiritual problem. And he goes on to say that the proper relationship between humanity and the earth, or its natural environment, has been broken with the fall, both outwardly and within us. And this rupture is sin. And so he says the church, reading the encyclical as he introduced it, he said, you know, the church now needs to introduce into his teaching about sin the sin against the environment, the ecological sin. Repentance must be extended to cover also the damage we do to nature, both as individuals and as societies. This must be brought to the consciousness of every Christian. So this idea of repenting, the fourth is very much linked to that, and that is to change your lifestyle, to live more simply, something I think that's very hard for all of us. So the Pope invites us to honestly recognize how we've often been affected by our consumeristic society and what he calls a collective selfishness. And then he says simply, make a new start. Take an honest look at ourselves, acknowledge our deep dissatisfaction, and embark on a new authentic path, a freedom, of authentic freedom. And he also invites us to be aware of the gravity of today's cultural and economic crisis and let this be translated into new habits. Easier said than done. And so we're called to the sort of ecological asceticism. It's not a very popular topic today, but it is important for us. And the Pope gets very specific about this, which is a little scary. So he says, for example, what does it mean, this care for creation? We have to do it through little actions like avoiding paper and plastic, reducing water consumption, separating refuse, cooking only what we can reasonably consume, showing care for other living beings, using public transport, turning off unnecessary lights. All of these reflect a generous and worthy creativity which brings out the best in human beings. The fifth and the final point, this is an image of Francis on his 77th birthday with some of the poor of Rome, some of the people who sleep on the streets in Rome. He wanted to celebrate his birthday, so he just invited people in to be with him. And the Pope makes very strong arguments that many environmental problems have an appalling negative impact on the poor. And part of Christian spirituality, part of living contemplatively in the world, according to Pope Francis, is to have this concern and this concrete, this practical care for the poor. So all of these five steps lead to what we might call an ecological conversion that opens us up to a more contemplative lifestyle. And interestingly enough, we have a quote here which I found very beautiful. It goes, the external deserts in the world are growing because the internal deserts have become so vast. And I saw that in quotation marks. I said, who quoted that? And I looked, and it was Benedict. So Francis quoting Benedict. The external deserts of the world are growing because the internal deserts have become so vast. So what does this mean? What does he mean by an ecological conversion? He means that the effects of our contact with Jesus become evident in our relationships with the world around us. So he also quotes, and I wanted to especially quote this for you, the Australian bishops. And he quotes them and he says that to achieve such reconciliation, we must examine our lives and acknowledge the ways in which we have harmed God's creation through our actions and our failure to act. We need to experience a conversion, a change of heart. So this is what he means by ecological conversion. So now I come to the end this evening. I've suggested that Pope Francis offers us new insights into how we can live more contemplatively in a world of chaos, and how he challenges us to share the good news with others. And to do this, we need to be transformed. I'd like to just end with two prayers. One is from an Australian, which I just found today. I like it so much. And the other is by Pope Francis. So the Australian is Michael Lunick. I like this so much. God help us to live slowly, to move simply, to look softly, to allow emptiness, to let the heart create for us. Amen. God help us to live slowly, to move simply, to look softly, to allow emptiness, to let the heart create for us. And we'll give the last word to Pope Francis in his beautiful prayer, a part of it at the end of the encyclical. He says, O God, bring healing to our lives, that we may protect the world and not prey on it, that we may sow beauty, not pollution and destruction. Touch the hearts of those who look only for gain at the expense of the poor of the earth. Teach us to discover the worth of each thing, to be filled with awe and contemplation, to recognize that we are profoundly united with every creature as we journey towards your infinite light. Amen.